Good evening, Mr. President, those who may be watching this on our recording. Most welcome this evening, and Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to all. Pardon me, the call is 7:30. I invite everyone present to please join with me to begin tonight's meeting with the observation of I now seek a motion to approve this evening's agenda.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councilor Legree, be it resolved that council approve the agenda of December 14th, 2023 regular council meeting.
Thank you. Council, all in favor? That is carried.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councilor Legree, be it resolved that council adopt the following meeting minutes. November 16th, 2023, regular council meeting. November 30th, 2023, regular council meeting.
Thank you. Council on either November 16th or the 30th, any errors or omissions? Not all in favor. There are no delegations and guests this evening, so we are going to direct the planning and committee report to Councilor Gordon for his hearings.
Thank you. Moved by myself, seconded by Councilor Hamilton. Be resolved that the Township of Admaston and Bromley accept the interim consent application B-1-2-23 made by Phil Dunhue and Helen McGregor, so long as commenting agencies are satisfied.
Thank you, Councilor Gordon.
So this one's for me a little bit because normally we have the consent to approve the severance and then the collective unit's own bylaw. So I did have to clarify that the county already did their own bylaw, they've already done their OPA, so now they're coming forward with consent for a severance. So it's just a little bit backwards.
Just to be clear, it is outside of your typically that you would see, but ultimately, this very involved process is atypical. It has happened in the past, it has happened. It began in the previous council, so because it did require a special permit, it couldn't be granted until that was done. So it is out of the order that we are typically accustomed to, but it is still following the steps and the procedure as required. I'm very pleased on behalf of our ratepayers that we believe this is in fact the last step for us to commission the tax to do this. And there has been a lot of agreement, thankfully, to come. Any further questions or comments, Council? See, not all in favor.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councilor Hamilton. Be resolved that council adopt the backyard chickens bylaw 2023-61 that is viewed and finalized by the Planning and Development Committee at the December 14th, 2023 committee meeting. And be it resolved that council adopt the amended fees and charges bylaw 2023-62 to amend the fees and charges bylaw to reflect the charge for permit for backyard chickens.
Somewhat of a journey, and we are at our destination, I believe. That's something to be honest with you, ready to be able. Any further questions or comments on the resolution or the matter before us? See, none of all in favor. That is carried. Thank you.
I think Jackie and I told Mr. Johnson notice by now, but as of the closure of this meeting, that bylaw is in effect, assuming that we can submit rest of the stages.
The bylaw states that the effect on the rest of the stages.
So the bylaw itself is not contained in the resolution, but the bylaw itself makes its effect. That concludes planning and economic development committee report. Thank you, Council, for the community services committee council for your.
Moved by myself, seconded by Council Green, be it resolved that Admaston Bromley Council direct staff to bring a report forward detailing the guidelines of the Ontario Aquarium Foundation capital grant.
So, we had a request from the Admaston Bromley Public Library Board to bring forward a request to apply to the Ontario Foundation Grant. It's the grant that they just to make the site that they need to use it. So, this is a capital grant, and at the time, under the discussion of the Library Board, I had asked that they maybe wait because the guidelines haven't been updated. So they did, however, still send me a question. So I've written a report that staff will bring a report back to council and let you know what it is. But the municipality, the library, because of our size, we're one. So the library cannot apply for a grant to the municipality. Only one grant application can go in. In other things, we are separate. So for student employment, the library can apply and the municipality can apply. So this one's a little bit different. We need to see the guidelines and see what's allowed to be applied for. I've been checking every day, actually just today, the guidelines came out. So I'm hoping next week to review that and hopefully to have a report ready for January 4th. However, we cannot apply to February 7th. So we do have some time. But the library would like to be prepared. Should council choose that they can apply for the grant.
Thank you. Well, I used to be talking about the brand council and the staff. Yes, thanks to the staff for putting this together. One of the main reasons for the lead time, to the credit of the committee, they were struck by grants and awareness committee, looking at all kinds of options on what's out there and available. They landed on to Trillium, they have in the past. I applied for Trillium. It takes a significant amount of work to put an application together because they need a minimum of 3 quotes for the purchases of whatever they're doing. So as much lead time as they can get to know that they can start that work in preparation of doing it. One of the main reasons for coming at this brief all the information required. These things that they're asking for in the matter are consistent with things that have been covered by Trillium in the past, and see no reason why they wouldn't be here. I guess my question, from my perspective here, there is some consideration given that other agencies within the township have also applied for Trillium. The rec centers in the previous past. Because it's in one municipal application, and I don't know this, but the clarity we're getting some of the rules and regulations, can it be one and can they be tied or amalgamated into one application versus only one choosing between one or the other? Okay, I believe perhaps this five and ten should be entering in the
field. So with the Ontario Trillium Fund, their application base is one project. So I know the recreation had also expressed interest in looking for whatever there was capital grants available for LED lighting for a community arena. I think it's all done then. So it would when the report comes back to council with outline of the parameters of the guidelines and everything, now that OTF has finally released them today, it will help guide council in determining what avenue they want to explore. But you would not be able to lump those two projects into one because they're so vastly different and they're two completely different locations and applications and everything. So unfortunately, it would have to be a decision between the two if the two were put on the table.
I was on the committee, rec committee, when they were given grants way back. And it seems like the library and the rec committee are so incredibly different that they wouldn't be able to apply together anyway. So either it will apply to what the library is looking for, or it would apply to building a new building or something like that. So if they're talking about the structure, if they're talking about electrical savings, that sort of thing, that might end up being better suited for one of the rec committees, and only one. It couldn't even go to both Douglas or ARC. It would have to be one or the other. But if it looks like it would be for the type of things that the library is looking for, computers and that sort of thing, then the rec committees wouldn't even qualify. So it would, just from doing current grants before, we don't get to decide savings size.
If I'm understanding correctly, though, Trillium was set to parameters and what is eligible. Dr. Hamilton is suggesting the library board is one way to do that. What kind of discussion has been passed to the county with the Trillium Center, but ultimately that's to be determined. But what I'm hearing is in the larger communities, each of the entities could submit their own, but there are somewhat constrained, which is, let's say, some follow-on at least in this room.
It is. I signed up for a webinar. I did a quick look at the grant today. It's overwhelming. I'm not sure if computers are going to be in it. Anything that's a town that is larger, yes, the library can apply for a town that is small, can apply for a town, but because we're smaller, we're only getting
to be clear, I'm not looking tonight for what can.
Yes.
Is it accurate, though, that if the projects that are proposed by each entity are eligible, is council the decider of which application?
Yes, they are, because it's the municipality who's applying for the grant, the library, and the legislature.
I did want that kind of council. And thank you for the work again on what you put forward in the way of means of report. I think this, if you shared this with the library, that this is the stage you're at, and this is what you're doing, or how you're doing it, how you're handling your request. They would be content until about January, at the point of time where you get the details that are required. And they did understand that the grant wasn't available to be considered now, but that there was going to be some time. This is as much as anything, awareness of what they see as their needs.
Right. And
then
if we reply back to the individual who sent the the grant comes open and they can start reading it as well and sign up for the webinars. I have that on my list of things to speak to.
Thank you very much. That's important. So, would only accept one application from one defender to be sent? You can't send two, three, but one or two? No. Second. Send one from the person back to something like that. I don't think it would be. What does strike me, so is the deadline for application the February 7th?
No, it's only
the beginning of it. And what is it?
March 14th.
Okay. All right. So that does provide some room. But ultimately, what I would suggest is both probably in January, we'll begin the process of council has to decide which of these requires some sense of
requested in the past, and having the guidelines
from the point of view. If there was, I know there was this previous year, have they is it a standard request at the council table, or is, do they need to revisit it from the committee? And
so they did ask for us to apply to children for lighting, and they were unsuccessful, and so it was our understanding that we would try again. So I will reach out to the community.
All of this is going to be required for council to make a decision. It is an unfortunate situation, but it's not the first time. I also think we're in a position that we should be lobbying a member of town, but at least being made aware that there's a small municipality where it's the township that can't put in like a large urban center.
I'd just like to add to Kelly and I both attended a couple of sessions, kind of work with the Ministry of Education and Cultural Sport. And she did a webinar on grants, and it was very interesting to see it has nothing to do with our members of family. It's the funders. If someone has given money to until a certain fund and has said how they want it to be spent, and it's Ontario Trillium Fund with them, not provincial and federal funding. So, they may have a voice to say it to them, but it's OTS that has made these guidelines.
So, that is
what
I apologize for that. Very, very thin understanding. But it sounds like you're suggesting that there's a voice to government funding.
Right, they'll get money from our understanding. People who want to see a good thing in the community, and they feel OTF is a good way to spend that to get the money out there. So that's how she explained it, that some of these organizations get money, and then that's how it gets dispersed, but they will kind of plan it to how they want the money spent. So it might be one group wants it spent on communications, one group wants it spent on accessibility, and that's how the guidelines are built. If there is nothing further, then all in favor. Once again, that's the council. Moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Green. Be it resolved that Admaston Bromley Council received the following from the Admaston Bromley Public Library Board, October 24th meeting minutes. Treasurer's report, November 2023. CEO's report, November
2023. Thank you. nothing to say in specifics, but just any questions, I can give it back to the library board to answer, just to then get the answers. You will notice that the treasurer of the library board is a provincial grant that they receive a significant amount, like $5,000 rings the bell. While they still haven't received their 2023 allocation. And it keeps getting later and later and later that they receive this. And I know they've compensated here and given money, but it really makes budgeting for this group very difficult when it's been a standard set down for the hasn't changed in, I believe, I don't know how many years, in terms of value. But here we are, the 1st of December, and I don't know if it's been anything. 2 weeks ago, the committee meeting, I'm aware that they were struggling with that work, and that money is getting a bit of a thing. I'm up with the consultants. I'm just going to come in and wear this to the council. Thank you. I do note, I think typically this is the issue. I shouldn't say typically. I don't know if it was typical. Last year, line, so it was an outlier, and it was December before it was received. So each year, I don't know if there's uncertainty when the budget and the library prepares its budget. I don't know if there's uncertainty that it exists or not. I mean, if there is firm knowledge that it's there, then it's a projected budget, and it certainly impacts your cash management. No pressure about that. There is no business coming, it should be a concern. Last night was the chief pickup to the chief librarian, and I got to ask the librarian if that was not being received. But it was December of last year. Council, so the questions are asked. I just hadn't been. It's kind of budget related to the library, of course. The township is related to the library budget. The only exclusive component that we have is the grants that we have at the library. So I note that within the treasurer's report, a couple things. One is the wages that could be just above the $25,000 that was budgeted. And I note also that. Curious is when we were setting our budget, the draft budget that the library presented to us, there was no budget for a photocopier. So that would be extra budget. And we provided, I think, something on the order of $3,300 less. The ask, I believe, was $27,500, maybe. And that was about $3,000. I have never seen the final budget of the library, so the question is there an anticipated fund for this? Like having made the purchase without having a budget. I will attempt to clarify it somewhat in the sense that they have their budgeting for this component of a new photocopier for 2024, in the budget of 2024, knowing that photocopier is struggling to maintain itself. Unfortunately, it crashed and burned, and it was either tried to adjust the coffers in such a way to pay for it outright and get one in place, which the committee chose to do, and pay for it now to get it there. How it gets budgeted is paid for now, so it can't be budgeted next year, but that dollar amount might show up in different columns of the budget for next year. It was just emergency things that the library was going to function. They needed to replace the protocol to do it. So I want to be very clear. The library is a standalone entity that manages its money on its own. I'm only inquiring about that because one of the early lines in here was that $2,300 can be spent on whatever collection. Just as the council delegate to the library board, I have a perception that there may be a deficit this year. I'm not sure what may be the funding deficit. In any event, that was the only and that concludes community services report and operations committee report, Deputy Mayor Hamilton. Moved by myself, seconded by Councilor Gurry. Be it resolved that the council received Public Works November 2023. Report as information. Thank you. And I will invite Mr. Hoskins to speak to the report. Thank you. November was basically just a preparation for winter. As far as we get wrapped up on small things, just that we did end up having to have special events in November. Back in 2020, we actually had three residents, which was one of the two. So it was kind of average. So we didn't know if we had to be able to feed up to the parents. Other than that, really just a little tweet that we met on the time has been replaced. It's been a wonderful job for our children. We're just making guardrails at the moment. It's expected to be done soon. Nature keeps up the way that it's well, I think the council probably is aware that maybe it's first out in, but I was a new part-time employee, Mr. McKeel, he's not here tonight, but it's been a very smooth transition. It's been a good time.
Outstanding. Thank you. Council, any questions or comments on the work report? There's no doubt that I would pass on the recommendation to the council. Very good job.
There is nothing from the Waste Management Committee this evening. Finance and Administration Committee. I Councilor Morley. Moved by myself, seconded by Councilor Hamilton. Be it resolved that Council accept the November 2023 year-to-date financial review report as information as submitted and circulated.
Thank you very much. And with that, this comment is for
you. All right. So November was a busier month as far as receipts for the balance of our funding sources from the Tyler Community Building Fund and Tyler Community Infrastructure Fund. We did have, in late October, the auditors were in to perform their procedural audit. There are a couple of points that were raised during that audit that I will get to in a few moments. One of the items was the invoicing to the county rental for the county forest levy. That was quickly rectified and invoiced to the county because it's not done through our traditional property tax system. It's a separate accounts receivable invoice, and there was a few other invoices that were sent out as well. I thought I would just kind of go through some of the line items just to provide a little bit more information because there were some questions raised. So, for example, on the fees and charges section, roads revenue in particular, we have budgeted $75,000. So far, we've received just $542,000. And this this revenue line item captures a multitude of things. There's everything from entrance permits to our aggregate revenue that we receive from the province related to the quarry. We charge the county for the road revenue. We also have some work in there that was charged to the public works staff to do emergency repairs on the ground hydrant that was completed as well. So those are kind of just kind of captures a number of items in that. In for the 2024 budget, this is another line item that is going to be kind of blown up and expanded, so you're going to see more of that detail on a line-by-line basis, so you have a better appreciation of these funding sources individually. It's not kind of buried in one line item. We continue to exceed our budget estimates for planning and zoning. You may have noticed that there has been no change in the interest that has been reported in all of our accounts, whether it's government operating account or OSIPs or gas tax. And that is due basically to the fact that the November bank reconciliation has not been completed. As you know, we are currently short staff in the finance department, and it is year end, so typically before you're reaching the end of December. It's a little bit crazy. There's a lot of extra payroll getting processed, year end, extra year end adjustments, and whatnot. So there's a lot of other reconciliations that are done that are taking a lot of time. So they have not been recorded, but I assure you there are a bunch of revenues that will be recorded in the next coming financial overview. One of the things I did notice when I was putting together a financial overview, there were a number of departments that were in a credit position for the source deductions, which I found odd because some line items still were and sometimes there weren't. I would have kind of expected to see them in a credit for all of them, whether it be income tax, CPP, or EI. I did investigate each of them individually, and basically what it comes down to is a timing issue between when payrolls were completed and our corresponding remittance to the Super General. So these are just amounts that are waiting to be recorded and remitted to the Super General, so these will be getting cleared out. With the admin capital, with our iCity migration, we do continue to slowly work towards it. I'm still waiting to hear for an updated timeline from our consultant or from our project manager. I think I had mentioned this at the last meeting, I have learned that one of our lead project coordinators suffered an untimely injury and is going to be off for an indefinite period of time, so they're kind of having to do some internal restructuring. So we're kind of working on that. Tomorrow they are supposed to be doing comprehensive updates, IT updates on a server that are associated with that are required for the software. So that's just moving ahead. So that's good news. The audit fees that you see, so right now this does reflect the procedural audit that was completed in October that I just mentioned, and then the balance of that will be issued once we complete the year-end audit, so there'll just be an accrual for the balance of that. The building wages and septic wages, again, when the budget was prepared, there was no provision unfortunately included for having the new building official in there. The only upside is that with the current building official, we are being reimbursed by 50% of the wages from the Township of Horton, so that will help mitigate those expenses. The fire wages, and fire support wages. So currently there's a little over $1,000 in fire wages. Those amounts are basically waiting to be cleared out and invoiced through accounts receivable back to the fire committee. This is again one of these back and forth things that is going to be eliminated in 2024. So we won't see that kind of in and out anymore. The fire support wages, that is actually not wages, it's service wages, but it's actually reimbursement to the fire secretary for various expenses that you incur, whether it's purchasing basically a variety of office supplies, whether it's paper and what have you. And I just today received the fire vouchers from the fire department. And one of those items was a comprehensive list of those expenditures. So they will be working through with our December financials. Do you want me to speak to the fire hydrant? I think there was a question about.
Revenue that might be coming in the public works, that whether be a line here that shows that recovery, because I think the still is
there is a small amount, I believe, still remaining for the dry hydrant. I did have a conversation with the fire chief this evening about this particular line item, and there was some misunderstanding as far as if there was amounts included in the budget or not, and unfortunately the fire committee had not included any provision for dry hydrants this year. So we will have to probably dip into the reserves, depending on how they fare out overall, like for the department, if they're in deficit or not. We may have to look at drawing funds out of reserve to cover those expenditures. Yeah, I think it's around $9,000.
Yeah,
it's what's left there right now.
Okay.
The other item too, I forgot to mention, there is a line item referred to as coding. It is not a budgeted item, but this is actually clothing that the volunteer firefighters purchase. So the fire department will purchase it and pay for it, but then they will recoup those costs or their charges through their remuneration at the end of the year. So we just processed the volunteer firefighter remuneration, and we reduced their revenue by whatever their corresponding clothing that they purchased. So that will get cleared out. The fire capital line item of just shy of $20,000, those are the costs related to the septic that we have. So there is money sitting in reserve for that, because we received we'll have to submit an invoice to get reimbursed for those costs under that grant application. Moving into the landfill area, the current expenditures are exceeding the budget estimates, and that's due in large part because there has been increased surveying and monitoring at the site because of the capacity limits. That's in large part due to that. Again, as mentioned in the other reports, there are a few items in the road overhead area which have exceeded budget estimates. And, for the garage maintenance particularly, there have been a few repairs that were unforeseen, which has caused, you know, the budget to be exceeded. Supervision, and again, this was the first year that we really had the opportunity for the Acton Public Works Superintendent to actually be more of a supervisory role instead of in the field and doing the work. So those budget line items have been adjusted and will be adjusted for the 2024 budget to better reflect those costs. On-call phones and wages, again, this is from something like the cell phone cost or something. It was a lot. Basically, there wasn't enough provision included for those fees. There was questions about the Lynch Road remediation. We have a little over $31,000, and the budget was $15,700, and we referred to the human tree provides the best explanation, and then the last item I wanted to bring to council's attention is in regards to the remittances to the county and school boards, and in particular to the county. So during the procedural audit, the auditors brought to my attention that there was an error, or there were errors with the tax rates that were included in the billings related to the county. And I was quite surprised, and that upon review, it in fact was correct. So the county passed their tax rates on April 27th, and when I started looking at the calculating the township tax rates, that was on May the 9th, I made the cardinal mistake of assuming that the county had updated their tax rates in OCTA, which we used to generate our own taxes. And those were the rates that I subsequently entered into our accounting system to generate our tax bills. The end result is that, due to this oversight, that there was roughly about almost $39,000 that was not collected from the taxpayers. However, we have still determined what the correct amount was to be remitted to the county. We have remitted the full amount, so there's nothing outstanding to the county. However, it does leave that deficit or shortfall with the municipality. I have spoken and discussed different options with the auditor on how we best to go forward in trying to recoup these costs. So one of the suggestions was to try to incorporate some kind of a line item to each tax bill, however, on the income tax bill. However, I would not support, I would not recommend going down that rabbit hole, because just of the number of adjustments that were processed in 2023, it wouldn't just be a straightforward, oh, let's look at their assessment for 2023 and multiply by the difference in the tax rate. You would have to take into account every write-off and supplemental that was issued on every single property. And as you know, with the Farm Forestry exemption, I had over 300 tax adjustments just with that one change in legislation, not to mention all the other numerous adjustments. The second option that the auditors suggested was to take money out of reserves in 2023, at the end of 2023, to invest that amount. Or the other final option would be to add it as a new line item to be collected through the 2024 tax levy. I do apologize to all of council for this oversight. I can honestly say I've never made this type of mistake before. The auditor tried to reassure me that I'm not the first person, and you're not the first time that this has ever happened, but this is the first time it's ever happened to me, and I'm quite disappointed in myself. So I do apologize to council and all to the ratepayers. But in any case, going forward at year end, it will be something that council will have to give some consideration as far as how we would like to best proceed with trying to make up this deficit. But at the very least, the council has received their full amount of what they were expecting and should have received. They have been squared away. It's just to figure out how to collect that difference.
Thank you. Can you confirm this, perhaps the concept is in our mind? So, OPTA is Ontario property tax. I think all of the municipalities have to submit their tax rate information so as to raise the required levy. And as I understand it, within any county, all of the lower tier municipalities and the county all have to be locked in. And if I'm understanding correctly, when we have seen those after the county had already adopted its tax rates, when you were on OPTA, it gave you a tax rate for the county that was not the actual tax rate for 2023. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. Specifically, in the past, whenever the county has adopted their tax rates, usually within 2 days, their tax rates have been entered and uploaded into OPTA. When I looked at the rates, because the rates still show the lower tier, they show the upper tier, which is the county, and also for the education, I did not verify or double check the rates that were in OPTA to what the county had actually passed. I just assumed 9 days later or whatever that they had actually updated them by then. So I'm not sure when, at what point or on what date they actually did get updated. But unfortunately for the township and when the calculations were completed, those were the wrong rates were entered in the right tax system.
Okay, and following that through, so I think county always gets its levy, and in fact, even on uncollected taxes, the lower tier municipalities carry the burden of uncollected taxes in case their fund is either there in whole or there is a tax sale, at which point then it is written off and the county has to participate in the write-offs. But the county always gets its money. So, we then, ultimately then, the source of this issue is that we did not collect the amount of money that the county was levying, did require was levying on their behalf, and this is left the gap. So, we are going to have to address that. So this is our last meeting of 2023. So, would you have recommendations then, Ms. Cobbett, on what would be the proposed means of remedying the situation?
Yes, I can revisit this issue with the auditors and also gain their insight into what recommendation they're also proposing. As I said, I outlined the three options that they presented when I met with them at the procedural audit. either taking money from reserves or adding it as a levy line item for 2024 would be the simplest options, because again, everyone is not that there was anyone person that wasn't treated equitably in the sense that everybody received that same inequity on not being charged the correct rate. So, you know, to put the extra charge as a single line item on the final tax bill or title levy to recoup the cost is one way of doing it. Or, you know, we take the money out of reserves. I am honestly reluctant to take money out of reserves just because I know we have a number of other expenses that are going to require those monies. But I will bring a report forward to the January 4th meeting for council consideration.
Okay, just finally then, before I open the floor for questions, so you did allude to this. So ultimately, when the final tax bills were mailed, I think there was a tax rate that was affixed to from the county. Everybody here has seen their own tax bills. That rate was inaccurate for the required sums for the county of Renton. It was equitably inaccurate right across every tax. So in fact, none of our rate payers were disadvantaged relative to any other. Ultimately, the municipality as a whole is in a shortfall position in terms of what we collected as the tax collector on behalf of the county. Is that accurate?
Yes, that is.
Okay, thank you. Questions, comments? Councilor Deputy Mayor. My based on this problem's discussion, I think my preference is still, I mean, it's a two-part answer. I think it could be accommodated in the budget. I think that decision is probably still best made perhaps in that first meeting of 2023. And where I'm going with that is you know, I'll be very careful not to prejudge the prejudicial. Off the top of my head, what I would suggest is to pull that into California, to pull that out of reserve, ultimately in the 2024 budget, it has to go in there to capture that plus what we would anticipate as the recommended levy purposefully in 24. So in reserve, that is an option for Deputy Mayor Hamilton, and maybe on the 4th. January, maybe that is an option council should proceed. I would say that's probably best discussed on the 4th first, and then set the road back. Thank you. Okay. Any further questions or comments? Okay, all in favor? Approved by myself, second by Council Hamilton, be it resolved that Admaston Bromley Council approved the payment registry for November 2023. Thank you.
So really, thing I would just point out again that the most notable expenditures during the month of November were the final remittances to the county and the school board. Aside from that, it was mostly just general standard remittances, whether it was repairs or annual or monthly fees for fuel or things like that. So that was the most notable. That makes up the probably half of the monthly expenditures for the month.
Okay, thank you. Any questions? done that, it was the staff and the council based on processing the payroll and expense, obviously, and expense reports as well. So, if you had, if council has the internal expense reports, when you're looking for them?
Tomorrow would be the cutoff to get them into the last step one for the year. Obviously, in general, you're still going to get paid. And they'll still get back to you. It's 2023, but
just for simpler accounting processes, but you can perhaps be forecasting business to find out what to do. So perhaps you can forecast what they're going to do to year end. One question just to make this a bit. Oh, so it is next week. Of course, next week is the last week before the rates that this is going to be. So there is a check point.
Myself, second by Council Hamilton, be it resolved that Admaston Bromley Council received the 2022 financial indicator review from the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing as information.
Thank you, Council Bromley. Once again,
So again, each year, Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing releases the overview of the financial indicators for the previous calendar year. And so I'm just sharing that information with council. They've also provided as well the, it's like a year over year comparative to the ministry's financial profiles as well. So if there are any particular line items that council may have a question about, I'd be glad to get additional information from MMA and bring it forward to them.
Okay, thank you. One thing, so council may have seen the 2021 given that the annual meeting was in November, in any event, Shelley used to always say, this is a very good piece of information, but be careful of the way that you respond to this. As an example, we had a discussion with a special host of the you are talking about two distinct things. The second thing I've never seen before, profile, I think it's called. Financial profile, that's brand new.
Okay.
I've only ever seen the three pages, and I think the third page is just a note on how to interpret the first two.
Sometimes.
So that has been the standard. The profile, the next resolution, the next report,
moved by myself, second by Councilor Hamilton, be it resolved that Admaston Bromley Council received the 2022 Municipal Financial Profiles from the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing as information.
Thank you. The response to the final question, these are the documents. Yeah, these are much more involved, much more information. I've never seen a consumer in this column. Is this the first year that we've received this?
I've never seen this information being prepared or released to municipality's drivers. So this must be something new that they are releasing to. It's using just the standard kind of three page that we just saw a moment ago.
Yeah. But by the way, what we're seeing here, even in the larger documents, is a synopsis of a bridge that can be created. If more information is available, if you are interested in sort of the market, anyway, with that, I'm going to yield the floor back to you.
Again, as you mentioned, it is a much more detailed outline of information. I actually kind of like this format a little bit better because it's a little easier to relate to. If you're looking at the line items, you know, even just basic things like number of households or the average total property tax, and then comparing it, those type of things. So, again, if there's any particular line items that council would like to get additional information on, I'd be glad to bring back to the future.
Thank you for that. The only comment I have is on the very first page, is page 59 of the PDF for council information. I think 2021 has to be mistaken information on population of households. The household is kind of pretty static from 20 to 21 and from 22, and the population is a wild swing. It goes down 400 and up 400. So be careful about it. I don't know if that has any impact on our approach. Something may have never been. But I find that out a whole lot of relevance. I'm pretty sure that in any event, council members, for the questions or comments on any of the profiles.
So again, I think that this is for a conversation. Not to be weighted over the heavy, but I did some math because it was interesting. We don't have the same services as some of the other urban settings, but compared to, I'm guessing that means south lower tier counties.
I don't know what the county, I'm assuming it's lower tiers within a county versus lower tiers within a region, because the county is rightly yet to its own, but its comparators are other counties.
Yeah, so that was my assumption, was that looking at the two averages, looking at the province, it becomes silly, because that would be the city, whatever, so larger tiers. But comparatively, I was looking at our taxes per household, which is one of my items, own source revenue per household, on a percentage basis, which we are kind of 55% of the average of the South Northern counties. So if I'm reading that correctly, that means that we are, each of our households is paying 55% compared to the average. And I realize the services provided makes a huge difference, you can't do a direct comparison.
Maybe it was because it was said. What I took from that is that we had more non-levy sources of revenue as components of our budget. I would suggest that as well, though, you can get the financial information here to because I'm quite certain that the city of Toronto's tax range is substantially lower than ours. these are very useful items of information, and they help to inform decision making. So it's certain, as we all know, if not all of them, and that concludes.
The resolution has been seconded by Councilor Steele. Be resolved that Council adopt bylaw 2023-60, being a bylaw to authorize the execution of a fire protection agreement between Corporation of Township of Admaston, Bromley and Corporation of North Admaston, Bromley, Forest
Thank you, Councilor Green.
And we've also put an increase for cost per firefighter per year. The reasoning behind the standby fee hasn't changed for 20 years. It does cost to have a fire department. So we discussed that with the federal workforce and they understood that. So that is why that change is there. You'll notice I've also mentioned in the agreement. If you went and looked at the agreement, I don't see that I put it in my report, but if you went and looked at the agreement, you'll notice that one of the newer points, mutual aid assistance, we've actually had it defined. It's defined in some of our other agreements as well. And then North Algonquin Resource did one change. They found that we are responding to too many calls that are ones that they can handle. So they've asked that be changed, and it's really nothing to do with us. They have to contact the communication center and have that changed, similar to what we did in 2022 for us as well. We actually asked for more calls and to some more vehicle accidents, but they want us to not respond to as many. However, should we be called, we will answer and they will take on the charge. So that's the main difference. And then if it becomes a mutual aid, it's after it's a term after an hour, not specifically an hour. It's a term that looks through all of the agreements that we have with the county as well. And then mutually, once you hit a certain point, the chiefs will discuss until it becomes a mutually agreement. So those are the things that we were able to do. And don't forget, of course, it's also one of the longer term agreements in the 2 years, so it's going to affect the agreement.
Okay, thank you. And just a little bit more. Clarity with respect to the evacuation area that we will be providing first response. Ultimately, the algorithm that has to be the process that has to go through the central communication center until such time as that is fully in place at the direction of the special funding of the river force, we will continue to be dispatched to the dispatch center. When all the information is taken,
this won't come into effect for January 1st, but once they knew that we were fine with them changing out their two-star and more amount of bonus, it was supposed to be the next two.
So I did raise this somewhat at the fair community. I'm fearful that this value is not enough. $7,500 was the proper price 20 years ago. $7,650 is not the proper price today. If you look at our fire budget, it is exponentially growing in the last couple of years, and this doesn't even come close to nothing. I absolutely admit it's actually nothing in the last 20 years. So something that I don't even know. I'm not going against this today, but maybe for the next 5 years I guess this is what we're going with. But I'm also fearful that by doing this for the next 5 years, we've now created that precedent that's going to be much more difficult to come back to them 5 years from now and say we didn't care enough for the last 20 years. I don't know against that. I don't know how to go with it. Staff negotiated this more or less in that deal. We wouldn't be able to agree. I guess I just don't like it. It's all I'm trying to say, but I don't know what our resolution is going to be going back to the table and see if it's going to be right
here. I will keep it through this track of the year, Mr. Waller. One of the things that I would say earlier is there is sort of consistent with the agreement that we have. Rentful is a wire, something I would agree with, white wire, and there are marijuana that's certainly consistent with the folks. It is a difficult concept to come up with, but I think we need to try to do this feasibly. So highly improbable, if we experience no fires,
we did mention that to Northrop on the workforce, but if we had been charging 50% on the loan, we'd be at a much higher rate. Our first meeting did not go over very well, and we suggested this, so we did not get a conservative approach, and in fact, this was the first step to move forward. But when we went back 20 years, and then that hasn't changed, and that the cost to have a fire department has changed. And that's what North Carolina would have to pay for, to have us ready to respond. And I think in our second meeting, the fire chief said he would admit that he did not want to lose us. But the fire chief and I felt that it should have been done previously, and it wasn't. And we really couldn't fault them, the two people that we were working with, and so we did do the 2% per year and increased the next time. But yes, we did not think it was enough either. But we did not think we could. We did not also want to, you have to look at it from the fire chief's standpoint. The fire department feels that they are there to protect everyone, and they did not want them to have more resources to say, okay, we can't afford this. Our fire department would be devastated to know that they couldn't respond to help people. So we did have to do a bit of a balance.
Thank you. I think the other president's first response agreement is one of the great things. Particularly those folks. residents. Imagine what the delta is in first response for the public. From the county of Renfrew, the county council summarizes the topic of the topic of the president. Please, the resolution is
moved. Move by myself, second by Mr. Field. Be resolved that council received the county council summary for November 29th, 2023.
Thank you. Council, questions, comments? Seeing none, all in favor. And bylaws. Council agree, I believe we don't need
that. Move by myself, the grounds of field. Be resolved that council adopt the following bylaws. 2023-60, fire agreement, notice outgoing road reports. 2023-61, backyard chickens bylaw. 2023-62, amend fees and charges bylaw.
Thank you. Council, you've read the resolution. Further opportunity for questioning. Seeing none, all in favor. And then final council agreed on the practice.
Move by myself, that the ban of the field be resolved that council receive the action tracking list as information.
We still have something here in the black and white to accomplish. We just really accomplish. It is on. It's not on here. Yes. If there was a win available there, but you undermine yourself. Council, any questions, comments on the action tracking list? I see no one in favor. For those watching at home, I am very concerned that the backyard chickens bylaw, that no storm has ever been removed. Any new business?
Just a question that
that is accurate and disappointed in because it is substantially below the allocation of the resources of 2023. Now, I do not know that. I don't have any information. All I am providing is what I read in the newspaper. We received $579,000 in 2023. Sorry, I'm incorrect.
I just want to interject. We did receive correspondence from the ministry, but if there's discussion.
no discussion of the federal allocations were to be moved until after the 7:50. Or I think maybe more costly, council on.
Not with that, it's already the news.
So, I just don't want to forget.
So, for everybody in the room, and those that may be watching this, on the date that we can, it's never happened. Any further new business? Seeing none, Council Hamilton, I believe you have a resolution to move into closed session. Moved by myself, second by Councilor Curley, that we be it resolved that the council move into closed session at 8:52 p.m. as per section 239(2)(c) of the Municipal Act, the proposed or pending acquisition or disposition of land by the municipality or the borough board, more specifically to discuss it also with the council. Thank you. Council, all in favor? thank everyone. I appreciate your patience. Moved by myself, seconded by Council Bromley, and be resolved that bylaw 2023-63 be allowed to confirm the proceedings of the Council of the Township of Admaston Bromley at the meeting held December 14, 2023, be now numbered and read three times and passed. President-elect, that's the one. Council, let's say you're all in favor. Question period. I see none. Councillor Howell, I believe you have a resolution. Moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Tilley, be resolved that the Thursday, December 14th, 2023, Council of the Admaston Bromley Council meeting be adjourned at 9:54 p.m. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councillor in favor. Thank you so much for your diligence. This is a long one, Council.